First of all, Jeanette, thank you, Reverend Wilson, for the opportunity to talk about mine and Eric, one of our favorite subjects, the Breadbasket Choir, or as they were called, the People's Choir of Operation Breadbasket. I came aboard in 1968 when I happened to come to a meeting and we were in the blue room, as they say, and Hazel Thomas encouraged me to come in. And from there, the choir grew. It was founded by Dolores Scott and Billy Jones. They were out of fellowship and they did a lot with the vision that Reverend had for the choir, and they went ahead and co-founded the Breadbasket Choir. I didn't intend to join, but because Hazel Thomas encouraged me, I did. And as the choir grew, we had so many great experiences when we would, as we say, put on the cape on Saturday morning, and then Mickey Warren would come behind us with "We Shall Overcome," precious memories. Oh, it was on. And I was hooked from then. I came for a day and stayed a lifetime. We had so many great things with Marvin, Yancey, and different ones. When Marvin would get happy, he would fall backwards on the organ. And we just enjoyed ourselves and the music that we did. Freddie Young, Billy Jones. And then we went on to Marvin Yancey. We traveled to Canada twice with Brenda Moore and the different ones, Kenneth Woods, Charles Clancy. We have had some of the greatest choir directors, but we've had the greatest choir. And for us, it was always about the music and the message.
So the music was message music. Eric Thomas, how long have you been were you with the choir, and how did you start?
Well, the truth is, I started around 1968 too. I was in college at that time. So most of the time that I sang with the choir was when I was home on weekends. But my mother also brought me to the choir. And the first time I saw the choir was at Mount Pisgah.
Yes.
And I walked in and here are these young people in a uniform I've never seen a choir in before, which was blue jean jackets, blue jeans, and white turtlenecks. And then when I heard the choir sing, I was just absolutely amazed, you know, by the songs they sang. And so when I got in the choir, my mother got out because there are some names that some people will know here. There was Audrey Booker was in the choir.
Yes.
Mike Knighton was
wow.
in the choir. Several other, you know, people were in the original choir. And to answer your question about the role the choir played in my life, the truth is I found myself at Breadbasket and Push. I began to grow as a person, you know, I developed friendships, and the truth is the movement was a way of life, you know. Mm-hmm. The movement was where you hung out, you know, you hung out at Breadbasket, you know, you picketed. Most of us, that, as a matter of fact, probably a big percentage of us that were in the choir were also in the youth division. But we all hung out together, we became lifelong friends, you know, and like I said, the movement, we were a family, you know, we were a family with a common purpose, you know. And I never forget Mama Helen Jackson, Reverend Jackson's mother, told me on an occasion, she said, you know, this is a collection of families. So I just would encourage young people to, you know, come here and form your own thing. You know, just like we did, you know, we were like a little movement within the movement, you know, form your little groups, your little youth groups. And I promise you, you will become a family before you know it.
And I want to leave with our audience and certainly share with them the fact that we can still change things. We are very important. The young people especially have to know that their role is very valuable, that there is a history in terms of us getting the right to vote, and they can be an integral part of whatever we do to keep ourselves hopeful, helpful, keep ourselves up and joyful about things, because the young people, especially even in my area, we have a lot of young people and they are constantly watching. They said, well, how do you stay up? I said, we have to keep hope alive. We have to keep on working. We have to keep doing. And we have to have the information, find out how everything has begun, find out how important the civil rights movement has been. It's not over. It's not over. And we want to just continue to infuse that hope and that spirit of excellence, spirit of love in our young people. And we want to share what we have learned. We sang, we marched, we prayed, to quote a song from Brenda Moore, it's reunion time. But the push is on because there's work for us to do.
On behalf of the ministers of Operation Breadbasket and the many brothers and sisters that comprise our organization, I would like to express my gratitude for your being here. We have several important items and issues to deal with today. Passion Play and Black Easter, the picketing, and some fights we're involved in. But before we get started, there's a black taping company in town.
Jackson's view was that in the black ghetto, we should employ a black film crew. Otherwise, we couldn't film.
Those of you with the British Broadcasting Company, I wish you would refrain from taping anymore until y'all clear up a little matter with them. We have a black company that is attempting. I think y'all ought to have the privilege to tape, but it must be up on the base of respecting black people. That's what this meeting, this particular meeting, is all about. So until we get that matter straight, I'll just be cutting them lights off.
Hi, I'm Ramin Hartman, and today we're at Rainbow Push, and we're having conversations with Reverend Jesse Jackson. And we're going to be talking to businessmen today, Mr. Eddie Ford and Mr. Caldwell. And we're going to be talking about the work that Reverend Jackson has done for 56 years, not just social justice, but today we're going to focus on commerce. We're going to talk about the economics of Rainbow Push. We had a business arm of Breadbasket. We went from the commercial division to the trade bureau, and we focused on business enterprise for inclusion and diversity.
One most unestimated part of black life is black business.
Black life is black business.
The largest employer of blacks in Chicago are the blacks.
Black business people.
Yeah, the restaurants and the cleaners and the barbecue places and the church and all that. We have more black than most second chance people. Now, we came here economic as a producers of labor. Labor was our wages. The consumers, we decided to turn the consumer strength into economic leverage. Mm-hmm. Every product in the store, 15,000 to 20,000 products, in our community, we have a lot of profit on. Mm-hmm. So we get a boycott.
Margin of profit.
But yeah, and what you find that as you get deeper is how creative we are. Mr. Eddie Ford is a jeweler.
Fine jeweler. Diamonds, sapphires, rubies.
He can do all that. But he's on TV, you know, like say Reeves are. Mr. Caldwell is a tailor and on the cleaners. And when we got started in the 60s, there were no blacks in Chicago who would be checkout clerks at the grocery store. So your senator, who was his godfather, trained
Mr. Caldwell.
Checkout clerks. Mm-hmm. Set the pace for the country. So in some sense, Breadbasket was about saying, give us a chance to economically grow. Now, with the fourth stage of our struggle, slavery's first stage, Jim Crow's second stage, third stage, right to vote. Fourth stage, last stage, capital. Mm-hmm. Industry, technology, deal flow. John Johnson built Johnson Publishing downtown. He owned a 30-story building. He was in the money to build on Richmond Avenue. He had cash. Herman Russell, and he was on a couple of bank boards.
In Atlanta.
They were lending money to build a six-story building on his own property overlooking the city. So the Zionists, white people can get more on an idea than we get on collateral. There's a corner that's 1,000 cars pass every day, and I think we should build a store, build whatever. And the bank's all right. Let's put the home and property and everything, so we can get the loan. So actually the capital is a big phase of our struggle. We learn how to maneuver the vote now. We've been voting like never before. With the members bring the dollar and the vote go hand in hand.
So Eddie Ford, you are a very unique businessman. You are a jeweler and have been since you were a teen. Tell us a little bit about your journey. And you've been in Jewelers Row, downtown Chicago on Wabash, for many years, and you do fine jewelry. Some of your customers have included Mavis Staples and Jerry Butler, Reverend Jackson, and the Obamas even. So how did you get into the jewelry business?
A man came up to me, and he was a jeweler. I'm shining shoes because I was working with my father part-time every other day after school. I would go downtown to Olympic Health Club and shine shoes, mop floors, and do all of the menial thing. I worked in Caucasians' homes, cleaning and whatever I had to do to make a living, to try to have some extra money so I could give my mom, because we were poor. And this man came up to me. He said, is your brother around? I said, no, sir, he's not here today. He said, I wanted to talk to him because I talked to your father about maybe he could come and work with me for 2 weeks. I said, no, my brother can't work with you for 2 weeks because he's in summer school. I said, but I might be available. I said, well, what is it that you do? He says, I'm a jeweler. I said, well, what about me? He says, well, I already inquired about your brother. He's 16 and you're not old enough. I said, he said, how old are you? I said, I'm 14. He said, well, you're too young. I said, but sir, I'm smarter than my brother. And he said, he just looked at me. He said, you have a shirt and tie? And I said, yes, sir. He said, meet me at 5 South Wabash.
So your first job was 5 South Wabash, and you're still there?
I've been in the building 63 years.
Oh, my gosh.
Okay.
Now, you've always been involved with Breadbasket Push.
Yes.
And you were one of the exhibitors at Expo.
That is correct.
So tell us how your business grew and how the organization, Reverend Jackson, assisted and helped you.
He teach you how to do jewelry?
Yes, he did. I went to jewelry school, too. And I worked under a lot of master jewelers, and I was an apprentice for like 15 to 20 years.
Really?
Until I went out on my own.
So you stayed with this man who hired you as a teen for about 20 years?
No, I stayed with him for 14 years.
14.
And I got, you know, I got crazy with him because he worked me so hard. I had to remind him. I said, have you ever heard of the Emancipation Proclamation? I said, because this is getting...
He didn't think it applied to jewelry.
He didn't think it applied to me. But in the meantime, I'm watching the movement, and I'm watching Dr. King, Malcolm, Paul, Gandhi.
So having access again was a big deal, right?
Yes.
Mr. Caldwell, you, Mr. Henderson, you went to tailoring school with Mr. Henderson after the Army, right?
Air Force.
After the Air Force, and learned how to be a master tailor. Tell us a little bit about your business and how it became so.
Well, I got discharged in 1955. Korean War was over, so I'm a Korean veteran. I attended Mr. Henderson's school. He had a school, Metropolitan School of Tailoring, and after graduation, 1956, along with Mr. Henson as my partner, because he partnered up with me and some of the other students that was fighting us, and we started tailor like clothing repair service. By trade, I'm a master custom tailor. Since that time, I ventured out into clothing care, so I'm a dry cleaners, tailors, etc.
How many locations do you have?
I've got 3 locations.
Southside Chicago.
All of them in Chicago.
Mm-hmm.
All of them on the south side. The my memory of Reverend Jackson is that prior to Reverend Jackson coming to town, Dr. King, we had several organizations. But what Reverend Jackson was able to do that none of the other organizations had been able to do prior to him, to my knowledge, because I was a businessman before he came to town, was able to bring us together. Now, we didn't have banks, so we couldn't get loans. And that was a big problem. You know, access to capital was very important to businesses. And we didn't have that. What Reverend was able to do when he came to town was bring us all together.
Business people.
Businessmen and women. Mm-hmm. And put us in a room, let us introduce ourselves to each other, tell each other about what we were doing, because we were so scared. We really didn't know the other businessman or woman.
So it wasn't just the external business, it was the intra business of us doing business with each other.
Well, it's about called cross-breeding the economy.
Reverend Jackson, one of the most pressing issues for business people, black business people, even to today, is access to capital. That is our loans. God bless investments. We won't even talk about that.
You're business people that you know, trust, and like. These banks are indifferent to black business, by and large, and the hoops they jump through is not known. For example, tell me this
expression. Mr. Caldwell, what's your banking?
Yeah, I was talking about access to capital. When I needed a gas line ran to open up my pressing for my dry cleaners, I wanted to get into dry cleaning. I'd been in the tailoring, alteration, that stuff for some years, but I needed to go into dry cleaning. And I went to downtown banks because that's what we had. And I went to Continental Bank. I asked them, I won $3,500. That was the amount of money I needed in order to do this, to run the gas. And I had to run the gas line, otherwise I couldn't press. They told me that their small loan started
$4
million.
$4
million.
So $3,500 was for naught.
So then we were there with Dan Lass Stevenson and said, put some in our banks. Your banks are too small.
Our taxpaying dollars.
Too small, our banks too small. He made an adjustment and began to put state treasury money in the bank. I mean, the economic is a fight. And we're still in that fight.
We're still fighting.
Silicon Valley.
What did you do? Did you get the money?
No, I didn't get the money. I didn't get the loan until 1965 when Seaway opened up.
Black Bank.
Seaway and Independence opened up in 65. We had been businessmen out here for some time. Ernest Collins, Al Boutte, those guys were around. We all knew each other, but all of us had the same problem. The reason why Seaway opened up was because Ernest Collins couldn't get a loan downtown either. So that was sort of typical of us. So when I got Joy Jones, who at that time had Joe Louis Snow, actually was serving on the board of Seaway. As most of you know, Seaway started off, when they first opened up, they had a white president. A white loan, chief loan officer. Joy Jones had told me to go down to Seaway and apply because he'd been trying to get me to transfer my funds to Seaway for my active business account. I had not done that, but I went to Seaway and they turned me down too.
Because?
Because I did whatever the reason, they didn't even take the application. But I went back to Mr. Jones and told him what had happened to me. He asked me to meet him at the bank. He asked me, could I meet him at the bank in an hour? Broke as I was, I had plenty of time. So I met him down to the bank, and I'll never forget this incident. He walked up to the safe, chief loan officer. He's a board member now of the bank. And he said, you know, this young man here, my office is right down the street from him. When I go to work in the morning, open up my office at 8 o'clock, he's at work. I close at 5. When I leave at 5 o'clock, he's at work. If we can't help young men like this, we need to get out of the banking business.
Did you get the loan?
I got the loan.
Bravo. But you needed a black board member to enforce, because you still, the white man still wouldn't give you the white banker, but still wouldn't give you the money. Eddie,
at the time when blacks were, for example, natural CNA, A&P stores like that.
Mm-hmm.
They try to sell their products, sausage or something. They said the color section. This is in Chicago, 666. It's not Mississippi, Chicago. So the first time they were able to make their bids in the open struggle, I think it also when we got to the big food show they have downtown, we had products without color on them. Peas. We had hits from Australia, all over the world, because we had an opportunity. Epinesis means a lot. Access means more. We don't have enough talent. That we have opportunity. Talent. We can do anything.
Eddie, now you deal with precious stones. You deal with diamonds. You deal with gold. What's your experience been with the banks?
Well, first of all, my story is a wonderful story, because I started my business with $600. And I couldn't get any help from any bank, because they told me I picked the wrong profession. There's no black jewelers, blah, blah, blah. And I also tried to get this office in the Mallers building, and they told me they didn't rent to black people. But as you can see, I'm the oldest tenant in that building now, okay? So I got that done. But I made money when I joined up with Reverend Jackson, and I listened to him, and I invested in Black Expo, and I made more money in Black Expo. I didn't have to go to a bank to get any money.
That was
because it gave me a jump start.
But also, gentlemen, and I was a kid, and I was everybody's secretary, but here's what the business meetings on Saturday did. They were lessons. They were classes. They were classes from Reverend Jackson on philosophy and even theology. But for us to be able to talk to each other about your experience, it wasn't Eddie couldn't get along. It wasn't Mr. Caldwell couldn't get along. It was that black folks couldn't get along.
Well, the main thing was back in the day, all black families had an account at First National Bank of Chicago.
That was the biggest bank.
And even when my brother here alluded to the fact that Reinsdahl gave him a jump start, all black people in Chicago were White Sox fans. Mm. So he made a lot of money. Comiskey made a lot of money.
And Reverend Jackson opened the door.
What really represents money? Market, talent, location, and
what represents money?
Where we live.
Where we live.
We're the market. Money, talent, location, and growth. You go to Norway, some small country, everything is built around that economy. Mm-hmm. We are consumers and workers. Mm-hmm. And we're creators. Mm-hmm. We creativity without access to capital. Without the deal of spice, he couldn't show you and me, he could clean uniforms. Mm-hmm. It's a chemical composition, right? Because you don't have the right chemistry, the uniform will draw up. Mm-hmm. You have to be able to scientific work. Mm-hmm. And he can make jury
draw a picture and he can make it.
Yeah.
We've been talking to Reverend Jackson, and we've been talking about his work in economic inclusion in America and for the growth and development of black business. One of the things that we've learned is access to capital is a problem. In our collectiveness with the three of us here, we've got about 200 years worth of business experience, and all of us have appreciated and benefited from our experience with Reverend Jackson in our businesses. Eddie Ford, what do you say today to someone starting, a black person starting a business in 2020? What do you say to them about banking and starting a business? What's your advice?
I would say take up an accounting class, either if you have to do it, you know, online, or go back to school, but learn about the value of investing your money and know what you want to invest it in. And make sure, if you're a person of color, that you will dedicate yourself to working harder than anybody else in any other race.
Would you tell them to go to the bank, get a loan?
You can try to go to a bank and get a loan, establish your credit if you have any, or start like we started, you know, with that dream that Dr. King had and Jesse had, and make sure that no one can tell you what you can't do.
John Jones could not get business on the right Negro Digest. He started going house to house doing consumer clubs. Mm-hmm. And everything you buy off the stand.
And with $500 from his mother.
Yeah, and so you have to, you realize you have no fun answer.
That's right. And Ms. Caldwell, $3,500, that loan was too small because $4 million was too big. You probably couldn't even think about $4 million. What would you say to a business person today?
No clue how much $4 million was at the time. I mean, I tell you the truth, I never earned that any money near that. As we must know, that you know, SBA was started in 1954, and it was not necessarily applied to us.
That's right, black business people.
Right, black businesses. So we had no sort of resource, nowhere to go. What I think that we, you know, more things change, more they remain the same. We need a Reverend Jackson in 2020 to bring us together. Because if and my business is a community business, I need people in the community to patronize me. Mm-hmm. That's my salvation. So I think that you know, somehow, and I know communication is quite different than it was in 1956 when I started, but it's still necessary for us to talk to each other, for us to know each other, for us to know what we're doing. Our businessmen and women to get together to know each other, like he started back in the 60s when he came to town. That's still necessary. I think we're becoming more fragmented like we were before. I really think black businesses today, especially middle black businesses, like you got this high-end business, you know.
Individualized.
Small businesses run this country.
I think, I want people now to join the Trade Bureau. We'll revive a consumer federation education.
Mm-hmm.
If you take a push card to Mr. Carl, you get 10% off.
At the cleaners?
Yeah. So
did Eddie give you 10% off too?
Yeah.
With the jewelry?
Yeah.
Eddie?
All of my jewelry is discounted because I tell people never confuse price with value. See? So I save people money. And another thing about me, I started with nothing. And I still got some of that left.
Well, I think the reason we want people to join the Trade Bureau. We're watching today.
Join the Trade Bureau, a lot of these issues can be discussed and even solved. Yeah,
because you in Kansas City, St. Louis, you still can cross breed, trade with each other.
Mm-hmm.
If we do that, then we can make it.
Because we can grow ourselves. Because there's growth internally as well as externally. Thank you for watching, being with us, Conversations with Reverend Jackson, and talking to business people who have benefited and experienced growth and development from being members of the Trade Bureau. And you should too. Thank you, Reverend Jackson, for all the work you've done. You gonna shake my hand?
Yeah, thank you, Irma.
Okay.